Good afternoon.
Hello.
Nice to see you. Greetings from Lausanne. It's indeed really a pleasure to welcome you for the session of today. I have to tell you, I'm really excited to share this webinar with you. We have attendees 110 around who are registering for this event and who are logged in. They represent around 30 countries, many different NACs, many commission representatives, and a wide spectrum of our airsport activities, which I see old friends, old experienced event directors, and some newbies as well. Today's session is about loggers, tracking, and the business case behind it. And of course, we all are familiar with these devices. We carry them with us all the time, be it a watch, be it a little device in our basket, in our cockpit, on our paraglider. And it's been useful since decades. What we now do and what is the big game changer is that we are finally able to share our passion, our achievements, our performances, our results in real time with friends on the ground, at home, or even in other countries. So the leitmotif of FAI, one of them is, the sky is our stadium. And the sky is our stadium, far away for many, but now much closer. So it's really a great pleasure for me to welcome you again, and let me stop boring you with too long speeches, but it's a pleasure to now introduce today's speakers to you. I welcome Marc André. I'm really delighted he's available for us, and Claude Weber. Just a short introduction before I share the screen back to them. Marc is the lead of the technology development. As you can see, he has been instrumental since a long time with loggers, trackers in CIA, in our FAI ballooning commission. He is based in Switzerland, an electrical and information technology engineer, a founder of several startup companies, and he's also currently working as a principal engineer in the medical device industry. Marc has been active in CIA since 2007, and has been particularly involved in the gas balloon competition, which you all know under the name Cooper Aeronautic Gordon Bennett. And further, he is the chair of the CIA scoring working group. Claude, welcome to you as well. Claude Weber from Luxembourg. He has been leading this project from the conceptual beginning. He's deeply involved in the financial aspects of what we are now seeing, but also the communication side of this very, very interesting project. Claude is living in Luxembourg, and he's the chair of the CIA New Technology Subcommittee, and of course, with CIA and the ballooning community since 2003. He has been involved in organizing and directing international events for the past 20 years. Claude is trained as a mechanical engineer, but he works as a teacher and IT project leader in the education industry in Luxembourg. I'm really pleased to welcome you and over to you, Claude and Marc, to proceed with your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Marcus, and welcome everybody. It's a pleasure for us to present what we've done over the past years, and I will try to share my screen so you can see my presentation. And it should be coming right now, hopefully. Oops. Just a confirmation that you can see it.
Yes, we can see it.
Oh, perfect. So.
And Claude, Marcus here once more, if I may add, if you have questions, raise them through the chat box. I forgot to mention that the chat box is on your screen. If you have a question, those attending, please write down your question. We will address that later. Thank you. Over to you.
Okay, thank you very much. So loggers in airsports, and well, particularly in ballooning, and we'll show you We'll give you a small, a little introduction to what ballooning sport is about for those that are not involved in ballooning and in competition. And then we'll present the two projects that we have been running. One started in 2007 and that now comes to an end. And the follow-on project, which has a larger scope than just being trackers and logging, that we called Balloon Life. And well, I'm sure you will understand the name afterwards. So let's go ahead. How does balloon competition work? Well, most of the time, balloons try to fly to a certain point where there is a target. So mostly it's about precision. They take off a couple of kilometers away, and then they navigate through different winds to that point. And at that point, at that target that is somewhere in the field, they try to drop a marker. And very often we're talking about meters and even centimeters of precision. Obviously, GPS is not good for that, but quite a few also in some difficult wind conditions, pilots missed that target or come close by 10, 20, 30, or even more meters. And then very often, especially if we go beyond the 50 meter, so what we call it a target that is missed by a pilot, he will use his GPS logger and mark a position. And then that's called an electronic mark. So he really pushes the button to say, this is where I want to drop my virtual marker in this case. And then he gets scored to that place. Then there are other tasks like the one on the left here. It's also marked by a target, but that's more to be able to find it in the nature. And there is a shape drawn with tape on the ground. You can see it here. And in this case, the pilots have to drop two markers inside that area as far apart as possible. So obviously the best would be this corner and this one, or this and this. Again, it's about precision, and all this is also measured by tape. There are people on the ground that try to measure the distances, maybe surveying equipment, but it's manual work. And still for the pilot, it is a precision flying. Then there are targets like this, or tasks where you have to drop again two markers as close as possible together, but in two opposite sides of these quadrants. So either AA or BB. Again, it's about precision. And then we have also tasks that are flown like these two here examples. One is an elbow. You have to fly point A, a B and a C, and then we calculate the angle between these two lines. Obviously, this is kilometers sometimes away or between these points. Which means that this is all done by GPS points and GPS marking GPS positions. 3D shapes is also a task that is sometimes very popular. So we kind of make a virtual airspace or space in the air, and the pilot has to fly through that space as long as possible or as far as possible. So we calculate the accumulated track distance through this space. Again, this is completely done by GPS, obviously, and that's why we need the track and the logger to do that scoring. How about the first GPSs that came into ballooning? That's 15 and a bit more years ago. All we had was actually normal retail GPSs. This is a Garmin Gecko that has been used, and it was not made for competition, obviously. So to make it more secure, tamper-proof, it was added to a box, kind of butter box, suspended up the balloon to make sure the pilot cannot alter any data on it. You can see this is not very professional way of doing things, but it worked at that time. It was the beginning of using GPSs in ballooning. And also at the result calculation, at the scoring process afterwards, it was a lot of work taking all these devices, do the readouts on computers and loading these tracks somewhere on the server and sharing them, scoring them, and so on. So a lot of work, but as I said, that was in the beginning. A few other downsides were like the recorded data was not usable for pilots. For example, he could not see what he was going to be scored to. He could not use that data that we would record for scoring. He could not use it for navigating. That was definitely a downside. It was not sealed, so not really tamper-proof, kind of, but with very unprofessional means. And it was completely missing marker drops. So if you're outside these 50 meters around the target, the pilot could not determine a position to which he would like to be scored. And then another point that we usually have in our competitions is declarations. Pilots might declare what they want to fly to next, choosing from a couple of goals. That is also not possible. And then came the balloon competition loggers. And Marc is going to tell you more about these.
Yeah, so we were really discussing those issues with the standard GPSs for a while. And then in 2007, Claude, can you go? Yeah. In 2007, we basically decided in a group with Claude, myself and a few others that we need our own solution for it. We were inspired by IGC elements, but at that time, it was simply not possible to impose a technology to pilots. Pilots would not be willing to pay money for it at the time. So we started building a proof of concept device, which you see here, which looked more like a bomb than a logger. But it basically showcased what we want to achieve. We started working on how do we actually make this a device? And then we approached Flytech at the time and started a partnership with them. The whole work went pretty quickly because already in 2009, the CIA decided to actually invest into devices, where a lot of us were actually surprised to the extent that we had to do a lot of work in the few months after the decision to actually be ready for the first Cat 1 event, still in the same year. But this all worked fine. We had the first European championship using it in 2011, and they just became standard for all competitions, especially European-based competitions. So on the next slide, what you see here is when we approached Flytech, we basically wanted to build our own device first, but then they were just about to launch their 6020 device, and we quickly figured that this basically had all the hardware that we needed for it. And the partnership then worked that we only had a very minor hardware change. It's basically a different keyboard for the device. And we wrote our own firmware or software for the device. So the whole software part was fully custom by CIA, but the hardware is basically a standard hardware that Flytech had. So how could we finance this? The problem was really kind of a chicken and egg. Like there were a lot of GPS devices out there. Actually the way they were operated, virtual events, or events where GPS tracks were used as the primary source, were very unpopular by pilots. One of the main reasons was really that they couldn't have marker drops. It was kind of a random flying around the field and then getting some result and having no idea where the data came from. But at the same time, it was also difficult to really say to the pilot, hey, you need to invest several hundred dollars for getting your device. So CIA decided to invest in building a first 40 units, which helped us do a proof of concept and really show that this is working, run smaller events. And then in the following years, we actually had the NACs invest into this. So NACs could invest buying 5, 10, or just 2 devices. Those devices were owned by CIA, so the NSC didn't own them, but in return, they got free rentals for their events to use that. And with that money, we were able to boost our pool to 120 devices without the CIA having to really get all that money from our reserves for it. And the events then could rent the devices from CIA and pay the rental fee for the number of devices used. For all of that, we did a lot of financial work. So from the very beginning, we had basically our own accounting where we were modeling income, operating costs, investments, and cash flow through the project. We always had a forecast and then actual numbers to really make sure that this project returns the investment to CIA. And we could basically work forward for this. And it helped a lot also working with FAI to really convince being able to spend this amount of money for lockers. So if you see the next slide, the project was actually very successful. What you see here is the blue line was our forecast. So the blue line showed a steady increase and then return on investment about 7 years after the start of the project. But in fact, especially also because of this model with the NACs investing, we had a break even after 5 years. And in the lifetime of the project, we made a profit of about 70,000 Swiss francs. So that profit is back at FAI CIA with the clear intent or with even like a motion passed in the CIA plenary that this money has to be reinvested into technology. So the plan here was never to finance operating cost of CIA, but to really reinvest into technology and use that money for the next projects. The whole logistic of managing such a pool is certainly very big and should not be underestimated. Initially, we thought we would have a commercial company doing all the management of freight and shipping the units around, but we quickly realized that this is not possible. A lot of events are too short after each other, so there's no way to return the devices back to headquarters and back to the place, and also the cost involved for that is too big. So we had a lot of transportations done by volunteers, so official pilots. Whenever possible, we had them carry the devices from one event to the other, because very often you have a person that wasn't the event going to another one, or at least meet somebody who goes there. So that kept our logistics cost very low, but it also had a lot of work involved, especially Claude communicating with all of the involved people and figuring out the best shipment plan. Within the Europe, we could actually ship the devices with no normal postal service. But for everything, especially also the transport for volunteers, we had a yearly transportation insurance. So that insurance covered any loss or damage on the devices while in transport, which covered like between events. Like they were not covered at the event. This was like the responsibility of the organizer, but between events. So let's say an official transports it, somebody breaks into his car and the devices get stolen. We want to make sure that the official feels safe about that and he is not guilty for losing a significant amount of valuable goods. And the same was also with transporting them with postal service to just make sure that we have this covered. We had a single case of a single locker once being stolen out of a shop box of shipment. Otherwise, we'd never use that insurance, but it was always good to have it. And we also had maintenance and repair. So a lot of, like you could certainly realize that the pilots not owning those devices, they certainly treated the devices less carefully as they would probably if they owned the devices by themselves. One important thing is customs handling, especially as the loggers are owned by FAI in Switzerland, and they travel all around the world. You need to make sure that you don't have to pay customs every time you get them across the border. So we had a so-called carne atta, which covers which is basically a transportation paper that has to travel with the devices. You stamp them every time you cross borders, and they are basically a guarantee that the devices get back to Switzerland within a year, and then you have to renew that carne atta. So how does travel like that look? So we have a presentation here from the trip into in 2014, where we once kind of made a graph for this. So you see they start in Lausanne, where we actually had the CIA plenary. We had them go to German nationals and so on, but the group on the lower end actually went to Australia and South Africa. They all gathered in the World Championship in Brazil and then came back and get distributed again along a number of events, both within Europe and within US or Canada in that case. So they were really traveling, I would say, twice the world in 1 year. So it's an impressive amount of work. And you see a few places where it says postal service, but everything else is transportation by officials. So if you go to the next slide, so the only thing that actually happens is the carne atta has to go back every year. And yeah, sometimes you can combine this with a good event and having some ski trip for Claude and having a good time on a day in Switzerland.
Okay, so I'm unmuted again. I will continue with why change? It was, it looked like a good project that was running well, generating quite a lot of profit. But standing still is never an option. I mean, you need to move forward. And what were the main reasons here? Well, the technology of these loggers was more than 10 years old. Servicing was needed. Although they were kept in very good shape over the years, still we had to think about more serious service. And actually the whole pool of 120 was nearly all still working, is still in working order. But nevertheless, we need to move on also with technology. And it was a lot of work, as you could see, to manage all the rentals, because there was invoicing to do, making the reservations, invoicing afterwards, checking all the transportation, managing all that pool maintenance. That was a lot of work. So we thought we need to do something about that too. We did that for 10 plus years now. And at some point, we would love to do other things than just managing lots of GPSs. Well, where should we head to? Well, first, it's the user experience and the user interface. We're all used to smartphones nowadays. It's a completely different way of interacting with devices. So that's what people are used to. And you see already where we're heading. I mean, we're doing everything on the phone. Why not this? Then live data. Today, we have the technology, we have the possibilities to transmit live data. It is has become a lot easier than I can think of 15 years ago, and where we also tried these projects and they never really worked because it was too complicated and too expensive at that time. Again, we're back to the phone and no pool. That was another reason, obviously, to go, and we'll see the solutions that are shown below. We'll see them now in more detail. We started with a vision and the goals. Where would we like to be or to go with this project? For us, it was important to make the sport attractive to the public and the community. As probably other air sports too, the community is not really growing rapidly or if at all. And so we would love, it's not a big community, and we'd love to make it more attractive to everybody, the public, obviously, also because we need the public and we need the sponsors that are directly related to the attractiveness of our sport. We would also like to simplify competition scoring and management. It has become more and more difficult to find people and find enough people and find money to pay all these people who are not really paid. But still, you have to lodge them. You have to kind of feed them, invite them to events, and at least pay a minimum. So this would all cost money, and we would like to simplify this scoring. All that apart from the more and more highly skilled you need to score all these fancy tasks with loggers and handling all the GPSs and so on. And then third, but that was more of an internal thing, is we'd like to keep the importance of physical targets, tasks, so really flying to a target, because that's what pilots still want. So we have to combine all this into one project. So basically, we thought we would go live. What we need is, and this is going to be this was the concept that we presented at the beginning, that we tried to sketch around this complete project. In the beginning, we need a central competition database. We need a place where we can store all the data about the competition, all the tracks, so that we can use it anywhere and as quickly as possible. How do we get this data? Obviously, it was going to be an app, a phone app, or whatever. It would be an app, and we'll come back later to the fact that we connected a GPS box. That is another detail. Second very important part is the platform that we would use for online presentation of the data. To the public, to the community, the scorers, to internal or external. And it would be live results, live tracking. It can be simple competition data, communications to the pilots, and so on. What we also need is manage all the competitions, manage all these events, having the basic setup of what flights, what tasks, what pilots, and so on. Then, as you've seen, we have a lot of targets, physical targets, where we use a couple of people, a couple of officials that are actually walking to the target and are measuring by tape the distance to the center. I cannot see any real other way of doing this with the GPS. Precision is not given, or the accuracy is not given of the GPS measurements within the centimeter. So we have to still work on tape measurement. But how can we collect this data? This was in the former days was all written on a paper sheet. Then the officials went back to the competition center. It was all translated into something that was usable by a computer. So that was very, very slow. We still gave it a try and tried to make a real-time marker measuring system, completely automated measuring also. And we'll come back to that later. I can tell you right now, it kind of failed, or the time was not ready yet. It was a successful part of project, but we didn't find a solution that was viable today. Then real-time scoring, that was never done before. And that's what we need. We need to show the result and the score immediately, or as quickly as possible to the public, and not only hours or even days after the flight. So far, scoring has always been done in softwares that were written by individual enthusiasts, people from the ballooning community that engaged, had a huge engagement and wrote these pieces of software. That was obviously always linked to that person. That was not a good way of making sure that system continues to be in place in, I don't know, 5 or 10 years. And there were a couple of these softwares, a lot of time invested in writing this software, and still it was not really good for this kind of purpose. And then we still had this item in, make the data available to external scoring systems, if there are any, or even external visualization systems, why not? Again, central database is absolutely needed. So that was how was born the Balloon Live project. Let's start with the logger app. So basically a phone and an app on it that would collect the data, and a GPS box connected to it for the sensors again, we're coming back to that because it has become a very important part of our project. What are the features, the important features of this app? Well, first of all, there must be marker drops, virtual marker drops, and you will see how that works a little bit later. We also needed declarations, and that's in place today. It has been the case with the former logger, and it is also the case in this app. That was pretty easy to do. Then live tracking, again, the phone is perfect for that if we have good connectivity. If not, then we have to buffer. You see a few functionalities of features that really needed implementation there. What we always also thought of is adaptive screens. I mean, the phone is perfect for that. You could actually think of, depending on the task the pilot is flying, the screen would adapt to show different things. I showed it in orange and yellow here because it is not in place yet. It's something we have envisioned, we have on our to-do list. It's not a priority number one at the moment, but still we thought of it. And result feedback, why not? Marker is dropped. Why not giving, if we have it centrally, the result, why not sending it back to the app, to the pilot? So he knows you've been measured at 1.3 meters on the target. Perfect, he's happy. He can have that result immediately because it's on the web anyway, hopefully. As I said, the phone or even the tablet is perfect to use it. So I think it was the perfect device to go to, and that's what we did. This is the app we developed. It got developed by a professional, by a company, professional development. We were very, very lucky to meet a guy, Julius Venskis from Lithuania, who already built, as a hobby, he built an app as a proof of concept. And so we joined forces with him, and he was from the ballooning community. And we thought, okay, let's get this moving quicker. So, and also in the scope a bit larger. So we took some budget and went to a company. Again, we were lucky. Julius worked for a company, a larger software development company. He did not work on the project itself, but it allowed us to have another developer joining the team who was kind of working in his company time for developing this. Developing an app is something that should go to professional developers nowadays. It's not something you can do just in your free time. There's so much to really provision in such a development that it has to go through professional development. We were lucky in that case also that these two developers, Julius more coordinating and still developing, and also Tadas, they were working, a part of their investment was, or in their time was from the company time, but they also invested a lot of private time improving it. So at the end, we got a lot more than really had to pay for because they have a huge engagement too, but still it was very important. It was obvious that we had to go to the Apple App Store and to Google Play App Store too. To give you an idea, it has two modes, competition mode and training mode. So in training mode, pilots can try the app and they can store the data just in a file on the phone. It's nothing is getting transmitted. And if you go into competition mode, that's where everything gets transmitted to a competition. Electronic markers, declarations, and so on. We used the IGC file format because it had become a standard in ballooning too. We kind of modified it. We extended it with some extra data that we integrated in there, but the IGC does very well, cope very well with this. It was a perfect format. And then a few other things, obviously, and it would send the live tracks to watchmefly.net, which I will mention later. Just to give you an impression of the app, it starts with the logo, normal screen. You can enter competition or training mode. This is where you declare, a coordinate, but can also sometimes use to declare times. What time are you going to take from point A to point B, for example? Or drop a marker number one, and then you can drop it at a certain time, big button, so everybody can hit it easily while in flight. Can become hectic while flying. So this works very well. We made it also available on the tablets, but that was not our primary focus, but it ended up being very useful because quite a few pilots are using tablets, and they actually prefer that way. So why not? Watch Me Fly is the platform. Again, we were very lucky to find a guy, Andrew Robertson from Australia, who had already developed something. And his website was more a pilot-centric place where pilots could upload their flights and manage their flights. And also he was collecting results, doing some analysis from competitions and so on. And it was completely transformed. He put a lot of effort in there into managing the competitions, managing the data, and it's a perfect connection for the app. So all the data from the app gets transferred there. So nowadays we're managing all the competitions in there. And it becomes a dashboard for the competition officials to manage their flights, tasks, set up competitor lists, and also communicating, and obviously collecting the tracks once they get transferred from the app. And this can be done live while the pilots are flying. At the end, the signature obviously is on the tracks also integrated. So that's very good. Live marker measurement, as I said, we tried it with NewSphere, a partner at that time of FAI and the engineering school. And I think it was a great project. They did a great work, and it showed that these markers here, as you can see them, there's some technology in there. The downsides was the price. You can imagine 100 balloons in a competition flying to 5 targets. That's 500 markers that we need at 100 Swiss francs each and more. That's not really viable yet financially. And also it took two minutes before we could really actually get the results, which was also still a bit of a downside. So we didn't continue to focus on that. And then came the balloon life sensor, and Marc is giving you a little bit more details on that.
Yeah, thank you. So first of all, why do we need the balloon life sensor? We already have an app. Every app has every phone has a GPS. Some of them have even barometric sensors in it. So why not just use that internal data? This is just a small example here on what you could expect to see based on GPS phone data. The first problem is you don't know where the position source comes from. Like, for example, on an iPhone, it doesn't even tell you if it's an estimate or if it's a true GPS lock on the developer side, but also other modules, like they always try to like assume some time of movement, mostly like you move on a street or something like that. And that causes the altitudes or different data to freeze. So on the right here, you see that the altitude was actually jumping on this recording. Also, we want to have variometer recording, which is not really possible with the phone data. And third is like phone position, especially on Android, can be modified by other apps. And yeah, even though we don't expect that altering data is a big issue in ballooning, we still want to make sure that there's not even a doubt of that people are doing any modification. So we came up with this sensor where it's basically a very good GPS, MIRBLOX type GPS sensor. It has a high quality barometric sensor. It includes internal logging just in case the connection breaks. And it also has data integrity and authentication for it. The app, like the sensor then connects with Bluetooth Smart to a phone, and it also offers classic Bluetooth and will offer USB serial communication to connect a laptop, for example, or a tablet for the pilot so that he can use the very same data for his own navigation. So this sensor, we were looking around what options we have for the sensors. And we pretty soon decided to do it based on the product called SenseBox from Flight Deck. This product is actually or was not in production anymore, but I was involved in the development on it, of it in like the late 2000s. And it basically was a very good fit from a hardware point of view. Nevertheless, we did we invested a lot of time updating the hardware. There's a number of components obsolete. We had to add the classic Bluetooth to it, a lot of firmware work, but also a lot of infrastructure for improving the production of the devices. So this is a lot of work that actually we as FAI CIA invested with volunteer work together with Flytech on this, or with Volirum on this. You can also see that the chassis was slightly modified. It's fully branded in the balloon life sensor, but also there were a number of mechanical updates to the chassis. The production is now down by Volirum. They are just in progress of finishing a lot of 600 units. This involves a lot of preparation work, getting all the components in, doing all the board assembly, which is also done by a company here in Switzerland, and do also all the testing of the devices before they get fully assembled and produced. So, as mentioned, they are currently in progress of the 600 lot unit. So how did we actually sell those sensors? The goal of the team was to make it very affordable for the pilots. We changed the method that we don't have a pool anymore, but we are now imposing the pilots to buy a device. So we wanted to make it in a way that they were willing to do that with a reasonable cost. So we worked really closely with Volirium to control the margin on this, because there was all the design work done by us, because we helped a lot in improving the process of the production. And we also, together with another balloonist, managed all the distribution for the units on this sale event. We could really lower the price to a very, very good price for those units. We then started the sale event in November last year with the expectation of getting about 150, maybe 200 units ordered, because the whole pool of CIA lockers was 120 units. And we were really blown away by 517 orders from the pilots. This was a very good surprise, because it really shows how much this project is accepted by the community. But of course, it again imposed even more work and concerns around production to just make sure that this amount of units in this short term can be built. And you can really see on the list here, it's spread around the world. We have 100 units going into the US. We have 50 units from Japan. We have 30 units in Australia, and like a lot of units in Europe. So it's also spread around the world. In long term, we might do another one or two sale events, mostly before like the first time we're going to use them in a world championship or stuff like that, just to make sure that we do offer the pilots the opportunity that they can get this to a very good price, because this is what we feel responsible as CIA to do. But there will always be the long-term option for pilots to buy them via the Volirum dealer network. You see that the price is significantly higher here. That really just involves, because there's now all the distribution work, all the building of single units is involved. So it's not the same batch production as we could do with the sale event, as well as the dealers, of course, need to get their margin as well. So this basically also explains the difference, but it also shows how much CIA worked on helping, trying to help the keep the price low.
Okay, so how to finance this, especially the balloon live developments, so the platforms and the app? There are two pillars that or two points of income that we live provisioned. One is the event usage right. So if you want to use it at your event, it's kind of a setup fee. It's an average 100 euro of smaller events, less flights, it's 50 I think, and it's 150, it's 200 for larger event like World Championships. I don't think that really matters in organizing a World Championship if you pay, have to pay 200. Then there's a pilot usage right that is actually paid by the pilot. If the pilot registers to an event, he pays a one-time fee for that event, and that is 10 euro, and that gets actually paid through in-app purchase. So it goes through App Store, and it goes through Google Play Store. The margin for smaller projects, smaller companies, has been lowered recently. It's a 15% they keep, but it's still enough for us. So that's another income. And then there's the app sale. The app itself costs around 5 or 6 euro in most stores. And to be honest, we sell 300 and we might sell 500 or 1,000 of these apps. It's still not the big income that pays for the developments and so on. So it's just to make sure not everybody just downloads it because it's for free and it generates a small amount compared to the rest. From BLS, from Balloon Life Sensor, obviously there's no income because that is paid by the pilots directly for to Flight Tech. So we did the same exercise. We did the same calculations. We looked at the possible incomes and we did some projections over the years. They were pretty conservative, let's say. We tried to not be too enthusiastic and keep the estimates of income very low. There's operating costs, obviously, also. And then the investments, they are just projected for the upcoming years until 22. And we'll have to see what we do afterwards. But so far, these were all the investments. These are actual numbers. And so this is where we have calculated if the project is viable financially. Again, showing this in a graph, especially have a look at the blue line, which is again, the cumulative cash flow for this project alone. And obviously it goes minus 60,000 Swiss francs investment, and it takes us over 10 years to return on invest. Yes, for sure, it's not a commercial project, so we're doing it for the sport, but nevertheless, you should always try to somehow get your money back at some point and not only invest. So it was about 10 or 11 years before we would reach that point. But if you look at the green line, and that's all logger projects summed up, you will see that with a profit from the previous project, we do not even go below the zero line, which is fantastic. Or you could even say, well, you have to invest even more because we're staying positive all the time. And if we don't continue to invest, we're going to raise that profit and continue to raise that profit. Of course, we're thinking of reinvesting continuous development and investments in the future. Who worked on this? It's a team. It's definitely a team from around the world. Sometimes setting up meetings is difficult because there's Andrew in Australia, but we work it out very well. We meet every 3 weeks approximately online. It's the way you do things nowadays. And Julius is more the app guy. Andrew is more the Watch Me Fly guy. Marc is a lot more on the sensor side. I try to coordinate everything and do the financial things. And Tad is also a developer, and Christian Michel from Germany. He's doing a lot of work in the support, in documentation, and also answering support questions and so on. How did we promote the project? Well, the project itself had its content and it was had its arguments in itself. So that's one thing. But additionally, starting off, we thought we need a good design. So we went to see a company and professional designers, and they came up. So that had some cost, but they were well invested. And we had some good visual ID that was done by that company, by a professional designer, and it pays back. It's nowadays you're used to having very good visual designs, and it must be, it's certainly not perfect, but just having this amateur maybe look is not convincing people anymore. So that was part of it. Then we have, and I invite you all to go to Facebook, to the project page. There's a page, and there's also a group where people can exchange. And in the page, we had from the beginning on, we announced the app, we announced updates, support we do sometimes, communication in general about the status of the project. It's all done by Facebook, and we gathered a community of around 700 people that follow us. That's really, really good. And our following is 763, screenshot from yesterday. So that really was helpful in getting the project out and known. We have a very good website. Please have a look. We describe in detail what all the different components are, what they do, what the project is about. We have manuals on there. We created manuals and guides and FAQs and so on. And we update them regularly. That was also very important and very, very well received by the community, by the pilots. Basically, when you receive your balloon life sensor, there's a QR code in it, and you come to a first start page where you get guided what you have to do to first start it and so on. This is also a lot of work, but it pays off because that's where you do things today, and that's the support, the minimum support you have to give to everybody. Balloon Life Contest is a decentralized competition, something we have not been able to do over the past decades. Now we have the possibilities, and we had a few tests last year, and so now we're doing one worldwide, obviously with the Balloon Life app and sensor being mandatory, and new set of rules has been developed. So it's also interesting to see the development of the competition itself. It's certainly not the way to go fully in the future. We want to be on site and fly to a target, but it's still another option, and get people used in these times is a great thing. Where's balloon life going to be used in the future? Well, we use it this year in smaller events. We try. It's a local competition in Canoundra in Australia that's going to use it next week. That's the very first. And then nationals in some countries plan to use it over the year or the season. It's used as a backup system at the European Championship. And maybe we can even use it at the Junior Worlds this year. And we plan for next year to use it in Category 1 events and maybe also in the World Championship. We'll have to see how it goes, but that is our plan so far. That was it. Little bit more in time than we expected. Thank you very much for listening. We have our contact email here. Visit our sites at the left, at bottom left, the balloonloggers.org, which is the old project, and Balloon Life is the new project, which we have. So both websites are available. Please have a look. Thank you very much. And back to you, I think, Marcus.
Yes, thank you. If you release the screen, great. Well, thank you very much, Claude and Marc. Appreciate it. It takes two. It doesn't only take two people to work on it, but it takes two main engines, if I may say so. Of course, you need a passion, you need a commitment, and you need people like you with skills. And that's one main ingredient. And I think that was very visible with all your partners you're working with. But it also takes a commission, a community, organizers, members who support this. You have seen that all this started with a strong commitment almost two decades ago with the very first investment, which kind of kicked off the project. And now we saw that it's self-sustaining and it's delivering even financially a bright future. So thank you very much once more to you both. We received just two questions, but maybe before we go to these questions we received, which we received in the chat box, could you just expand a minute or two on the role of Watch Me Fly and how this platform on the web helps to then transmit the data, managing the event, promoting the event, and showing the event to our community who are watching and participating in events from the distance, which then builds on the technology you just presented.
Maybe I can answer quickly on that. Watch Me Fly was existing. So we took that over. He actually joined the team, Andrew, and it is not completely branded Balloon Life, because we thought Watch Me Fly is a good name and we wanted to keep it. It's kind of a partner, but it's an integral part of the project. All the data gets actually stored on Watch Me Fly. All the tracks, track points, everything gets stored there, and it's the management for running a competition on Balloon Life. Visualization is a project in itself, or is a part of the project. So far, showing it on a screen, on a Google Map flat, maybe with targets and so on, is exists today. So that's possible to show it to the public, to show it also to the pilots and to the scorers. Going towards something that we've seen in America's Cup or other great competitions where we see amazing things, is certainly something we'd love to go there. But if you've seen our budgets, that's not so easy. So at some point we have to team up somewhere, and we're open to give our data, not to give it away, but to kind of give access to the tracks to an external company that may have visualization elements, and they can sell it. So if an event is interested in teaming up or buying such a service from a company, we would be open to provide the data, which is certainly a good start. I'm not sure we will ever build such America's Cup features ourselves. That's just completely out of scope financially.
I think one thing to consider as well is, like, ballooning is, if you would want to call it, like, a rather slow sport. So I don't really expect people watching at home a full, like, flight from ballooning and really kind of cheering with what's going on. That might happen with Gone Minute. That's a completely different topic, but not so much with hot air. One really important thing where I think the live element is really important is the live scoring. Currently in competition, it takes hours after the last balloon has landed till we have results. And that's just like late news. Like, this type of news never gets around. Like, you, if you have to announce, oh, by the way, on our flight yesterday, we now have a winner, that doesn't work anymore nowadays. So I think that really at least the initial priority on the live aspect is really to get live scoring, to get the results done as quickly as possible, because that certainly makes it also more attractive to public, let's say on site, that they get the winner while they're still on a site for a ballooning competition.
Thank you very much. I appreciate especially your last comment, because it's all about bringing our sport across from the stadium in the sky to people on the earth in a short period of time. So thank you for that. Let me just point at the questions which we received. Elena. Elena is the CRVL coordinator. She deals with major hang gliding, paragliding events all the time. So very close activities related to logging and scoring. She's asking, why do we need to drop a marker electronically and not just take the best track points out of the GPS log? I think we do both, but maybe you can just summarize.
Yeah, you can do both. That's the way we went with the retail devices right at the beginning. And it was not highly appreciated. It was not really appreciated by the pilots, because it took the decision on where they want to be scored out of their hands. Obviously, we need them for elbows. You need to mark your positions because you have a strategy. You want to have that point being scored and not another one, and not the best one. And determining what's the best in your triangle is possible, yes, but you get the results afterwards. So you know what you've flown once you're on the ground and it has been scored, which is not what the pilots wanted. They wanted to know to be scored to that point and then take the decision themselves.
Thank you. So the active choice of which position I want to be logged is part of the strategy, and it depends on the task before and on the potential task following. That is something which is very special to ballooning, of course. Thank you for that. John Gruppström, PAS CIA president and FAI president, not CIA president, FAI president, sorry, John, you were asking if GFORCE microsensors can be added to this device.
Yeah, we do have accelerometers and gyro sensor inside the device. We are currently not leveraging it. But yeah, the sensor itself is already inside the balloon life sensor.
Thank you for that. I'm just going through the questions. There's another question from an airspot friend. I don't see the full name, but can life positions be transmitted to other devices in real time? And either directly from the app or via WatchMe flight? And what about latency and position frequency on the app?
It could be used. As I said, the platform is designed to be open. So we could give external systems access to the app, to the data if we'd like to, but it would also always go through WatchMeFly, the central database. We have on WatchMeFly a feature that allows the pilots actually to generate a link that he can share with his crew on the ground and maybe other teammates, and they can see where he is. That is real time. And for scoring, for public, we have decided this year at plenary that there should be a minimum of 10-minute delay. So that's our internal policy at the moment, but we're open to anything. The app itself will not transmit to any other devices.
Thank you. And I think you said, but not sure if I missed that one, I think the whole system works even without internet connection. I think that's important to know. So when there's a disconnection,
yes,
the data are uploaded as soon, maybe even later in the competition center. So this even works in remote areas without internet coverage, but of course not live then, but data are stored and then uploaded automatically.
Yes, exactly. It's buffering in the app. It's also stored on the sensor. But basically, the idea is the pilot goes to the briefing before flight. He has connectivity. He takes the flight definition and all it needs, goes out and flies. And when he comes back, he connects to any Wi-Fi, and then it offloads completely. It's not a problem. But this is exactly what I was talking about when you develop an app properly. These are all the features that you need to implement. All the different deconnecting from a sensor for a certain time and so on, and also buffering. That's a lot of work that you usually don't see when you see an app as a user.
Thank you very much. I'm just moving on through the questions. John Grobström from Sweden, one more question. Talking about the future and the option to add a webcam someday to the functionality.
Why not?
Maybe in 5G times, lots will change, but sure. not planned through this. Thank you. And then there are more technical questions. Let me see if I understand this on the recording. Yes, it will be made available. You will hear from us when I close the session. There's a question on GDPR matters and services that can be used. I would like Rune, you asked me from Denmark about GDPR. Go to the FAI website so that you see the FAI policy related to privacy matters. There's a long statement there, but I can also confirm that CIA is quite advanced because this commission always asks for the pilot's consent when they register for an event, that data are being used and can be displayed for the purposes which have been presented. But visit the website or raise the question with Marc and Claude. From Slovenia, if they're training tools for officials, I think you should refer to the website, if I may take that question already. And then something again for the two techies, Claude and Marc. What about standard requirements for API access? Do you have an API for mobile phone apps for the sensor? That's a technical question.
Well, the work that we were doing right now, the unit is really produced from Valerium for ballooning competitions. I think there is only an option to open that up, but that has to be discussed both with them and with my involvement on the software side. So we don't publish right now the API because the interaction between the sensor and the mobile phone is really intended for the Balloon Life app. It also only accepts a single connection. in any case, other apps and especially laptops and so can connect with standard Bluetooth and USB, and they'll just receive a standard NMEA data stream with the position. So that's currently the main interaction to be used there. If there's any specific projects, of course, get in touch with me and we can discuss if there's anything potentially open for other exports.
Thank you very much. Claude.
Yeah, Marc, maybe I can add something to the previous question about training. We are planning on having trainings also for officials. The balloon life contest that we launched that will start on 1st of May is a very good opportunity for officials to learn how to use the website, how to use the data, how to score with it, and so on. So we plan to do some training sessions and invite officials to join that competition to at least work a little bit with it. And maybe and that's what we have started thinking about, kind of certifying or giving a certification, not in a very official way, but still kind of, kind of an award, mm-hmm. recognition mm-hmm. of the skills. And then, that's what we're trying to set up right now for the coming months.
All right, and then thank you. Then there's another question pointing at other airports, like you mentioned the IGC file, which is widely used in other airports as well. We have the Open Glider Network and the question around FLAMS, and Elena made a comment that this is very similar, the functionality which you presented to what is in use actually in CIVL. But I think that the beauty of this is the fully integrated approach, reaching out to finances and to the refinancing. I think that makes this system very much standalone, even though technology, of course, is similar. But would you elaborate on the proximity of this and maybe integrating FLAM devices in the future? Is that something not for balloons warning each other, because we see us apparently, but other people flying around us?
So yeah, I think the question on the FLARM was more like IGC and I think a few other airports start to use the FLARM infrastructure to basically use that as the live tracking infrastructure. We looked at this as an option for the ballooning. We basically decided against this. The main reason is balloon competitions happen in areas where you usually don't have pre-existing OGN coverage. It's not really in the mountain type areas where you have a lot of glider activities. And also we want to be able to have the balloons visible, especially if they're flying low. And this is where like networks like OGN have bigger issues. And then we just also decided in terms of cost for the whole infrastructure and the use case that we want to use the mobile phone as the user interface, that it just makes sense to do this based on the mobile phone network. We are fully aware that there will be cases where we won't have enough coverage to really have like live tracking on flight. But because of the buffering, it will not affect actually how competitions run. So we consider this manageable. And at the same time, we certainly expect also with 5G that the mobile networks will certainly improve. They already improved in the last 10 years a lot for covering those areas. And additionally, balloons often don't fly that high that they are above mobile phone coverage as well. With regard to integrating FLARM in terms of collision avoidance, actually for ballooning, we do have a collision problem because you cannot see everything which is above you. So the balloon really, really covers, I need to look up the numbers again, but it's about 120 degrees of your visibility looking up. And this is an issue, but at the same time, we also said the FLARM technology is not the right technology because FLARM is a collision awareness system and not an avoidance system. And the pilots would immediately fully trust the system and just race as quickly as they can, assuming there's no balloon above them. But you could in fact have a balloon where the system is deactivated, malfunctioning or whatever. And actually, if you do the risk management, you will end up seeing that the risk is higher with such a system than no system, and having the pilots use their common stuff with talking to other pilots and finding out if there's somebody on top of them. Just a side remark regarding like this collision avoidance system around ballooning.
Yeah, thank you very much. There's one more question about the privacy matter and a question on who owns the data in the end.
Yes, the competition rules state about this in ballooning, and they belong to the pilot. Data belongs to the pilot. And this remains as it is. But by using the system or in a competition, the pilots will give permission to watch me fly, to use it, to show it under this delay, for example, and so on. So this is the way it is set up at the moment.
And it's mandatory. You can't show up in a world championship and say, I don't like this. So this is now an introduced feature, mandatory, end of story.
Yes, it that's it. We must say that in the past 10 years, where we used the data, this was never a big issue. It was never a discussion with pilots saying, oh, this belongs to me. And it's written in the rules, yes, but it never became an issue whatsoever.
Well, thank you. And also thank you for those who submitted questions, John, Elena, and all the others. Very interesting. Thank you, Claude and Marc, for replying to them. We are really good in time, a little over, but not too much. So let me just summarize where we are headed right now. FAI, CIA, of course, we knew about the widespread interest about the topic of today, as reflected by the many people registering and attending today's session. So that was encouraging to do it, but we may do more. And in order to find out if we met your expectations, what we will do early next week is we'll share with you the contact details for your follow-up questions, specific questions of Claude and Marc. And also we will share with you the presentations, and we will let you know where the recording of today's session will be saved. It's not planned to put it on YouTube, but we'll provide you with a downlink to a cloud space on FAI servers from where you can get the data and today's webinar. And we'll ask you in a survey what we should improve. We will ask you about feedback and other ideas you may have for future similar things. And then we'd like to hear from you how to move on. Again, on this note, Claude and Marc, again, thank you very much for your time today. And I thank all the attendees from all over the world for taking the time to join this session. I think it's good to see the complexity, the technology, but it's even better to see faces who stand behind such an idea, to see how a commission over 2 decades now was supporting the development, how widespread this now is, and how we finally reach a position to share the beauty of our air sport by using technology with people already now and even better in the near future. So thank you once more, and have a nice day. And thank you for all who contributed, Marc and Claude and all the people in the office, Faustine and Visamati, for some technical and communication stuff in the back. Have a good day, and until next time. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.